Trish and Adam. Yes, we're here in Washington at the IMF World Bank spring meetings, and I have a special guest here, Stanley Fischer, joining me. He is the governor of the Bank of Israel. He is one of the wise men in the world of central banking. Good to see you again, Stan.
Nice to see you.
First, I want to start with a broad picture of the global economy. Where are we right now in this recovery?
Well, we, that is the United States and most of the rest of the world, are recovering or have recovered. And Europe is still very uncertain as to what's going to happen, going up and down, and the weakest part of the global economy. So that's roughly where we are.
When it comes to these unconventional monetary policies that we're seeing around the world, you were just giving a speech in which you said QE can be ugly and it can give you a sense of worry. What do you worry about?
Well, mainly we worry about things that we haven't anticipated, and every now and then something happens and catches you by surprise that you don't know how to deal with it. QE is what I actually said there was, people think it's one, we find it wonderful to be doing all these mysterious and complicated things. We don't find it wonderful. We'd much rather life was more simple like it used to be, and we just had to change the interest rate once a month and could then go back to reading our books or whatever we did in the interim. It's not like that anymore.
It's not like that anymore. Do you see any of these so-called risks out there right now?
Well, the European risk is not particularly related to this. I think it's related to having a very complex system where you have the fixed exchange rate, countries at different stages of development, and no real centralized decision making except in the European Central Bank. That's a very, very complicated mixture. And that's a place where one has seen risks. I mean, the Cypriot banking deal was something which you wouldn't have expected to happen, and it probably shouldn't have happened.
And yet the Europeans are here at these international meetings, and they're touting the progress that they've made and saying, defending themselves, saying they've made the right steps. Have
well,
they?
In the large, that's true. I think that somewhere around the middle of 2012, they made decisions that were really very, very important, namely the Draghi statement on that they do whatever was needed to preserve the euro, decision to go to a banking union, a decision which seems to be in the process of being implemented, and then more the hope than a decision to move in the direction of fiscal union. Those are big decisions, and they have made a difference. Now, you know, around that, they have to make day-to-day decisions, and some of those haven't been so good.
What would you like to see from them next?
More coherence, more consistency, all the things that are very difficult for them to do.
From the fiscal authorities.
Yes, but more fundamentally, to really take their banking sector problems seriously and try and get on with fixing the banking sectors in a variety of countries. I think whereas the U.S. in 2009 did the stress tests and they were serious and started recapitalizing the banks, the depth of the some of the problems in some of the European countries hasn't been recognized yet.
Recapitalization, bank recapitalization.
The need for recapitalization. Yeah.
I want to also ask you about Japan. Everybody's buzzing about that around here. What's your impression of the Bank of Japan's shift in monetary policy lately?
Well, it certainly has a logic and desire to be even more expansionary.
And is it going to
we
work?
Hope, well. That's the experiment we're all watching, and it certainly goes in the right direction. How big the impact will be is very hard to tell.
What about the impact it's having on the Japanese yen? Is that a cause for concern?
You know, the Japanese economy benefits from what's happening to the yen. So that is to the good from their viewpoint. There are other countries whose currencies have strengthened against the yen who are less enthusiastic. But, you know, Japan being as sick as it was for as long as it was, you've got to cut them some slack in allowing themselves to work their way out of this situation.
Well, you mentioned that some countries might not be so happy with the appreciations in their currencies. Are you bracing for sort of a new wave of competitive devaluations, currency wars?
I don't think we've had currency wars. We've got to deal with the consequences of what other countries do to try and get growth going. And, you know, we have a set of measures. I wish we didn't have to use them, but that's a complicated world we live in. We'll do what we have to do and try and preserve the growth in the Israeli economy, which has been very good.
And speaking of the Israeli economy, you're due to step down from your post in June. What's next for you?
Oh, I really haven't wanted to look into that until I step down. I've got a lot to do in the next 2 months and a couple of weeks, and I don't include in that wandering around talking to potential people.
Well, there might be a job open at the Federal Reserve as chairman. Well, is that something that you would consider?
I prefer not to go into that at all.
Do you have a specific contribution that Ben Bernanke, your former thesis student, has made on monetary policy?
Oh, I think he's had a phenomenal impact on monetary policy. I think we're all very lucky. He and the Fed that he's the chairman of have done what they have done.
Right.
We thought in October, November 2008, we were heading for the Great Recession, a Great Depression. We got nowhere near there.
Right.
U.S. unemployment maxed out at just over 10%. It had been 25% in 1933.
He saved it.
He saved it.
All right. We have to leave it there. Stanley Fischer, great to talk to you. The Bank of Israel Governor Stanley Fischer. I'll send it back over to you, Trish. All right.